I was dreaming of bigger things and wanna leave my old life behind.
Take one drive in the most awarded and best-selling SUV brand and discover that the world is your backyard.
Have you noticed, maybe it's just me, I've been traveling a lot the last couple of weeks, so this is fresh on my mind. Fast food is getting bad. Like, it's always been bad, but because the prices are going up, it is no longer worth the price.
No.
Fast food's value has tanked. Like, I literally never want to go anymore.
The only fast food I'll eat is Culver's or Dave's Hot Chicken, because those have
those
were always like higher end fast food, but now McDonald's and Burger King are like catching up to them, so like it's the same price for the shittier food.
That's exactly what I'm saying. Why would I go, if a Big Mac meal is gonna cost me like $10, why would I not just go get something better? It's gotten a little weird. The whole appeal of a McDonald's meal was it was like $5 for a lot of edible food.
Yeah, you could go there, you know, completely drunk off your ass at 3 a.m. and like just pay with pocket change to feel vaguely satiated for 5 minutes.
Yep. And I don't think McDonald's is going to collapse anytime soon, but I do think they're in a bit of a crisis. And it's not just them. Burger King feels the same way. But every fast food I've been to in the last while has been really disappointing for how much it's starting to cost.
It is. There's all kinds of reasons for that. And we don't want to like do the boomer thing of like, oh, they think they should get paid $13.
I've already done it like 4 or 5 times on this show. The dollar menu used to be a dollar.
It's just like we're feeling nostalgic. But like, no, like there should be a food option for, you know, people who are homeless or, you know, like college students or you know, high school students like us who didn't have rich parents that like paid for all their right. shit. You know, there should be fast food for like stoner idiots. And like you, when you enter, you sign a waiver that like, you know,
if you get sick, it's not on us.
Like we don't follow any of the health codes. No. The FDA like never visits this place.
This is 50% cat meat.
But you get a cheeseburger for 59 cents. There should be that in society.
I actually agree. I think there's a market to fill that we're missing.
Yeah.
It used to be Taco Bell, but even then, it's like six bucks a combo now. That's too much.
Yeah, it's a shame what's happening.
Nick and I will
Bell.
Do what it takes to bring you a $3 combo meal.
Whatever
you
it
won't
takes.
Like it.
All right. Welcome to Polishing Turds with Nick and Cal. My name is Nick.
And I'm Cal.
And this is the show where we take a deep dive into the wonderful world of bad music. I've been thinking about doing that for like 5 episodes now. I just never had the balls until that moment.
I loved it. I hope it makes it into the recording.
I think your son would be proud of that little move over there. All right. Welcome to part 2. We are still talking about Imagine Dragons. And I know to Cal's absolute delight, I have recently decided to expand this series from 2 episodes to 3 because there's just too much goddamn shit I got to talk about with these like just wonderful Mormon-y fucks.
I think it's tradition at this point that whatever we think it's going to be, it's like 1.5 times that.
Yep. we just budget that in like mentally.
It won't be 7.
No,
I know
for God's
that.
Sake. No, I can't handle that. But no, we're an episode into this series. And has anything you've heard so far, Cal, changed the way that you think about Imagine Dragons?
Yeah, actually a little bit. Imagine Dragons is starting to remind me of Black Eyed Peas, where yes. I can't parse out where the business ends and where the artist begins. Mm-hmm. It's this very blurry line.
Yeah.
I'm not sure else to put it. It's, is Dan purposely making soundtrack music, or is he so Mormon that his brain, this is what he actually thinks is cool?
For the most part, I'm kind of on the side that this music that he and this band is making is a genuine reflection of what is in his soul, and that by just virtue of just the accidents of the cosmos happens to be what every advertiser realizes is going to touch the human psyche enough to make us buy all their products.
And as unlikely as that sounds, it sometimes looks like that might be what we're looking at.
There's 8 billion people on Earth, and, you know, some percentage of them are making music, and just, like, mathematically, some of that music is just going to be perfect for the next fucking Transformers soundtrack.
Exactly.
I've had this weird dichotomy, this cognitive dissonance in my head, because the Imagine Dragons that I hear in their singles that I've hated for the past 10 years... And the actual interviews that I've read with Dan, like, or that I've watched, like, he just seems like such a normal, relatable guy in so many ways. And yet when you hear his fucking songs, it's like, it just, it makes me hate him all over again.
It's like finding out your friend does like a YouTube children's toy videos or something. It's like, you're so normal in every other way.
You're better than this. Why? But then, like, I happened to be talking with one of my friends who used to live down in Florida, and she actually worked at Disney World back in, like, 2016-ish. And one day when she was working at Disney World, Imagine Dragons happened to be there.
Like, oh, shit.
Like, I think they were just, like, having an outing, like, just being at Disney World. And she described their vibe as being kind of douchey, in her words. And she noted that the man that we later identified as Dan Reynolds was walking around wearing a leather jacket in Florida in July. And for some reason, just that one detail alone, like, he's wearing a leather jacket in 90 degree fucking Florida weather. That made me turn on Dan just a little bit.
It wasn't Believer. It was that.
It was that. Like, I don't know why, Cal, but is it just because he's aware that cameras might be near him at some point? I don't know, man.
I think that's the cause of some of his angst we're going to get into. He's a very nice Mormon boy thrust into the world of fame. And we know how messed up that can be for people from doing this show.
Yeah.
And he's now insecure. He can't go anywhere without being Imagine Dragons Dan Reynolds.
It can't be worth it, man. Like, I'd rather be broke forever.
Completely. That's, I think, my biggest takeaway from running this show with you.
Fame ruins pretty much everybody that we've ever talked about. All right. So, in terms of this episode of this series, here's how I'm kind of thinking about it. In our first episode, we were talking about Imagine Dragons as a band formed in Utah by a depressed Mormon and his musically talented friends that kind of bounced around the Vegas casino scene until they discovered a hip-hop producer who gave their music that it factor that it needed to, you know, light up the charts. And it's a weird story, but I think in its own way, kind of relatable.
I think it's the millennial dream, actually.
Yeah.
You're just some normal guy that got thrust into this band because you're that awesome.
Yeah, there's this, you worked hard and the stars happened to align. But from here on out, like this episode and then into the next one, we're going to be talking about Imagine Dragons, the entity. This is like the Imagine Dragons that we have feared since we signed up to do this series. This is where Dan Reynolds and his friends, they're not just playing these like shitty ass casinos. They're playing sold out stadiums. They're like dominating what little remains of rock radio. They're in every fucking soundtrack, every car commercial, every video game. They were even in a fucking Las Vegas tourism ad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is the point where just no matter who you are, what your age is, what religion you are, what ethnic background you have, like what your taste is, you can't escape Imagine Dragons. And that's why I imagine, that, no pun intended, that most people listening to this series, even if they've never gone out of their way to listen to Imagine Dragons, they're going to hear the songs that we play in this episode and be like, oh yeah, I've heard that somewhere. I had that happen to me.
If you have legit never heard of this band, I actually don't believe you.
Yeah, like
I don't believe you.
Like if you've ever been outside or inside, like,
yeah,
or if you have ears, you've heard Imagine Dragons.
Even if you insulate yourself from this every way you can think of, do you watch YouTube? I'm sure it popped up in one of the ads.
Yeah.
If you've seen an advertisement, you've heard one of these songs.
So yeah, this is it. Welcome to the new age.
I know you couldn't resist. I still appreciate it.
I know. I live for these, you know, like dad puns. But nonetheless, Cal, I invite you and our audience to somehow try and interpret this band sincerely.
I will try. It's going to be a stretch.
Like, no matter, you know, which of our theories is true? Is he being cynical? Is he like, is it an authentic representation of his soul? I really do believe that every Imagine Dragons song, it begins in the thoughts and emotions of Dan Reynolds, right? And he likes to talk about his songs as these kind of journal entries. Like we talked about how he writes a song a day, you know, that song could be his way of processing whatever shit happened to him that day. And he's just been doing this since he was literally a fucking child to deal with all of his problems, to deal with, you know, his mental illness, his crises of faith. And then, you know, later, as we kind of alluded to, the pressures of fame.
Mm-hmm.
But my point in all this is that unless Dan Reynolds is some master charlatan, which he may be, there's no reason, I think, to believe that these songs don't come from a real place. Even when they sound like just the shittiest thing you've ever heard.
I actually am starting to think that. So they're popular enough that when you stream their music, you can just get the lyrics in real time.
Yeah.
So I sat there watching Imagine Dragons lyrics scroll by as I'm listening to these fucking songs. And I do actually think that.
Yeah.
They are coming from a real place. He's just blessed in the sense that he doesn't have to dress it up or make it artistic in any way, and people still eat it up.
Yeah. He could have some of these same lyrics and like be like a guy strumming an out-of-tune acoustic guitar against a wall in some cafe talking about his pain and
right.
Shit like that. It's just like, it's not, you know, coded as such.
Right. Well, I'm starting to realize, I think the most modern generation, they would rather, if you're going to write a song about how you feel bad you got broken up with, let's say.
Yeah.
I think they would rather hear you say, and I've never been hurt so much, it felt so bad, than like, I'm a desert rose wilting away. Like, they'd rather hear the straightforward Dan Reynolds-ish version.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Because why cut out the middleman?
Right. And so I do think it comes from a genuine place, but I think he's also smart enough to know, don't dress this up in any way.
Yes.
Just say what I am what I'm feeling at a third grade level.
And, you know, to that very specific point, Cal, we're going to return in part three to like where Dan takes even that to an even more extreme, you know, conclusion.
Dan mad. Dan don't like.
I mean, you joke, but it's almost that bad. But to kind of like demonstrate what I'm talking about, this like kind of duality of how we can interpret Imagine Dragons, I want to kind of highlight one particular song at the beginning of this episode. And this is a song that, for whatever reason, like of all the Imagine Dragons songs I've been listening to, this one has been in my head maybe the most. This is a single from their 2017 Evolve album. This one is called Whatever It Takes.
Falling too fast to prepare for this. Tripping in the world could be dangerous. Everybody circling as vultures. Negative, nepotist. Everybody waiting for the fall of man. Everybody praying for the end of times. Everybody hoping they could be the one. I was born to run, I was born for this.
Whip, whip.
All I do is win, 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 no matter what, what. You ever notice how similar all this shit's getting? Sorry.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, just, it's such a very specific vibe.
This is a Big Mac, man. This shit is a product, straight up. I don't know how else to put it. They're selling you. You want to have the best set at the gym you've had? They're selling you that in musical form.
No, I mean, I kind of love it for that reason.
Yeah,
you know?
That's the five-hour energy of songs.
Like, it just really is just dialed in. But, you know, like, I got to confess, whenever we study a band for this podcast, that band lives in my head rent-free, as they say. Yep. And, you know, it'll come to me in times where I'm not necessarily expecting or even wanting it to come out. You know, so at my job, sometimes, you know, I work really long shifts. Like, I work in retail, and, you know, a lot of times that line of work can be stressful and difficult. There have been a couple of like 10 plus hour days that I've been working recently where, like, if I just really got to like dig deep and like, you know, motivate myself to continue doing this shit, this whatever it takes.
Right.
Whoa. Just, it just, it fucking, like, it's...
It's dialed in,
dude. They're fucking in my head. They're pulling strings, you know?
Well, we're at the point where we could... Let's say I work for an unnamed coffee brand. And I say, I need a song for that feeling when you wake up in the morning, that first sip of coffee hits your lips and you're energized and ready to tackle your day. Imagine Dragons could write you that song.
Yeah.
Easily.
That's what they live for.
It hits my lips. I'm ready to go today. You know, like, it's... I've never heard music as a product so blatantly until this band.
One of the quotes that I really loved about this song in particular was there was an article in Billboard magazine written by a guy named Andrew Unterberger, and he quoted that this song, quote, packs enough lyrical adrenaline to soundtrack ESPN montages for the rest of the decade.
I love that. Because that is such a shift, too. Like, it's not like this music will mean something to you. He's just straight up saying, like, it's for montages and it's going to be great in them.
It is. And, like, and like, I think ESPN did use this song in montages. Like, it'd be criminal for them not to. They could probably be sued for disappointing their shareholders or whatever if they didn't use Imagine Dragons.
And that's where it's so tough to analyze this man. Did he purposely set out to make an ESPN football montage song? Because it sure sounds like he did.
Well, let's dive into that, because that's kind of like where I was going with all of this. You see, the way I see it, there are many ways one can interpret this song, but I want to highlight three. Now, the first is what Cal and I just alluded to. Like, just literally, this is a cynical attempt to create a sports anthem. And if that was Dan's goal in writing this song, it was a phenomenal success. So just to name a few examples, this song was used in the video game Madden 18. It was played before tip-off at Utah Jazz basketball games. It was used as the theme song for the WWE event Battleground. That was just from one Wikipedia page worth of looking into this. I'm sure you could find dozens and dozens more.
You could put this on the pickleball championship and it would fit somehow.
Oh, for sure. Like, you know, fucking water polo to yep. imagine. You could make a badass montage of like water polo
yeah.
to Imagine Dragons. In fact, you know, I challenge you guys, if any of you have like footage of like your kids is like, you know, 8-year-old lacrosse games or something that you want to do, like just make an Imagine Dragons whatever it takes montage to like them like missing at t-ball.
Just imagine you cut the 5 misses and then the one where it kind of rolls all the way to first plate, that's the whatever one you put whatever it takes.
and it'll immediately look badass. You could do a controlled study where if some like a baseball prospect sent a highlight reel to various, you know, like teams or whatever, pair that with this song and yeah. it's gonna do better than if you paired it against like just like a generic like fucking Foo Fighters song.
That's
or whatever.
An amazing thought experiment. I've never thought about that. Name. You send a highlight reel, one is set to Will Smith's Wild Wild West and one is set to Imagine Dragons. I bet you the identical clip, I bet you the Imagine Dragons wins.
Yeah, for sure. Now, the second possible interpretation of this song is to look at it the way that Dan Reynolds wants us to look at it, as an authentic expression of psychological struggle. Now, we've already talked about Dan's lifelong struggle with depression, and as much as this song feels like a pump-me-up anthem, there is an element of gloom underneath it all. So, we're going to have a little fun, Cal. It's been a while since we did kind of a Polishing Turds dramatic reading featuring the talents of you.
All right.
So, I want you to just channel your inner drama kid and read out these lyrics with all of the like anguish and melancholy that you can muster.
Always had a fear of being typical, looking at my body and feeling miserable, always hanging on to the visual, I want to be invisible, looking at my years like a martyrdom, everybody needs to be a part of them, never be enough, I'm the prodigal son, I was born to run, I was born for this.
Well done.
That last non-rhyme threw me a little.
it's like I was born to run. What could I do? Born for fun, born to bun. I'll just say born to bun. Who cares?
If I don't rhyme it, will anyone actually notice?
Dan Reynolds is the king of like rapping without rhyming.
Yeah.
I mean, just imagine like what Cal just read to you with like a little soft piano, like minor chords in the background.
Yeah, if I had sung it, it would have been a little. I did like a beat poem, but.
Like, you know, and looking at my body feeling miserable, like these are things that he talks about in interviews all the time. Like he really does struggle with depression. And I'm not trying to minimize that. I'm not making fun of him for it. Like I fully believe what he's saying. And I can honestly relate to a lot of that too.
Well, and I think he has some of the problems that come with a high performing family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Where you, even when you're an objective, let's say 8 out of 10 human,
yeah,
you can sometimes feel like a 2 or a 3 because you were subjected to such constant pressure your whole life.
Yeah. You've got like 6 or 7 older brothers and they're all crushing it. They're
one
all...
gave you your career on a platter, yeah. Essentially.
But like, they're all like, you were the first guy in your family not to graduate from BYU.
Yeah.
You're the first guy in your family not to have a postgraduate degree. And like, we kind of undersold it in part one, but like, he really did have a period where he was kind of struggling with his parents.
Oh, I
like,
bet.
About like his decisions in life.
Well, and you have to kind of know a little bit. Whether it's true or not, just in the back of your head, you're telling yourself, I'm the runt of the litter in a way.
No, like for most of his life, he felt that way. And I really do think that like the way that we feel in childhood, the roles that we're given in families, like it primes us for the rest of our lives. Like it doesn't matter that, you know, he's in his 30s and he's a rock star now. In his head, he's still that little boy who can't measure up to his brothers.
Right. Especially if his dad hates his music.
Yeah.
Who cares how popular it got?
I read from genius.com occasionally. This is like the big website that aggregates lyrics to like every pop song in existence. But one annotation claimed that, quote, Dan feels he has sacrificed his years and perhaps his childhood to achieve success, and that he has been paying his dues in order to rise to the top. And again, these things are written by like fans, right, essentially, but it's plausible.
I can see him feeling this way. Now, we've covered enough artists that actually grinded to get to this level.
Yeah.
It's a little hard to empathize with him, but I could see why he feels this way.
For sure. As much as, you know, their grind, they had the way paved for them in a lot of ways, for sure. But they weren't an immediate overnight success. They did pay their dues in a certain sense. It wasn't like Avril Lavigne where it was like here you go, you're a pop star, you know? Now, those were the kind of the main two ways to interpret this song. But here's a third interpretation that I think kind of combines the cynicism of the first with the armchair psychology of the second. See, I think it's possible to see this song as a reflection of Dan's conscious or unconscious ambition to push Imagine Dragons over the top. Because I think that as much as Dan Reynolds isn't like a typical rock star, you know, although, you know, showing up at Disney World in a leather jacket notwithstanding, like Dan will do whatever it takes to keep Imagine Dragons at the top of the charts. He will do whatever it takes to earn them more money than God. He will do whatever it takes to produce whatever combination of sounds he thinks that the greatest number of human individuals are willing to press play on. Like, he just, like whether he will admit it to himself or not, like, just, he's going to do whatever it takes to make a song that a lot of people are going to pay money for.
Yeah, it's White Will I Am.
Yeah.
It really is.
He is White Will I Am. Like just, I've avoided that metaphor, but it's just, it's absolutely
true.
It
is. He has that drive. He has the desire to be famous. I think he views it as his ticket to being accepted in his own family.
Yeah.
I don't know how to see it any other way.
No, 100%. Also, like, this is a completely random aside, but I read somewhere that this song was also used at the 2018 Conservative Political Action Conference, which just,
yeah,
it makes it so much darker.
I know, with what we're seeing now.
Like, they will do whatever it takes, yep, to implement a fascism and, you know, just destroy everything that's nice about the world.
And that's why our time doing this is limited, Nick.
But let's kind of get back to the timeline of our story. We're going to travel back to 2015 and talk about Imagine Dragons' second album, Smoke and Mirrors. Their first album, Night Visions, that's the one with Radioactive and Demon. So we've already got a bunch of like bona fide hits.
Yep.
Like they struck gold with their first album, which is an enormously rare thing for a band to do, but also puts them in a position where like anything short of like an equally stellar second album is going to be looked at as a disappointment. And we saw that with Billy Ray.
Yep.
You know, we saw that with a number of guys that we've covered.
There's a reason the phrase sophomore slump is a phrase we know.
Oh, for sure. Now, you know, in the meantime, they waited a couple of years before releasing their follow-up, but to kind of keep fans satiated and keep themselves relevant, they did release a few singles that just somehow magically ended up being used in soundtracks.
Ooh, how could it have happened?
there's a song called Battle Cry that was used for Transformers Age of Extinction. There was a song called Warriors that was used for the 2014 League of Legends World Championship. And I was going to play one of these songs for you, but then I realized I don't need to.
No.
These songs sound exactly the way you think they sound. Just in your head.
I'll give you a guess. It goes, Warriors! Warriors! I don't know. Probably not, but... What I just did could, with production, become an Imagine Dragons song.
It's just like that whole It's just that whole vibe.
Yeah.
Like, just picture the climactic scene in a Michael Bay movie. Yep.
And you just need an epic, slow stomp-clap beat and chanted vocals, and you're on your way.
Yeah. Like, that's exactly what we're dealing with here. But anyway, 2015 rolls around, and we finally get Smoke and Mirrors. And kind of like the vibe on this album is they were just trying to essentially do what worked on Night Visions again. They were just doing more of their percussive indie rock with these big ass production sounds, and just all of it in the service of music that is relentlessly in your face,
mm-hmm.
you know, as you know, any of us would expect. So to kind of give you a feel for how most of this album sounds, let's listen to the album's second track, which is another Alex da Kid production. This one is called Gold.
Fast comes the blessing of all that you've dreamed, but there comes the curses of diamonds and rings. Only at first did it have its appeal, but now you can't tell the false from the real. Can you try?
I mean, just what's going on in that song?
Dude, this is some Icarus stuff here. Like, you'd think a guy who went to BYU would be more aware of the dangers of getting this level of ego after one album.
I don't think he means it literally. Like, I think it's like he feels like everyone's kissing my ass now.
Yeah, no, it's I wrote Radioactive in a notebook when I was 18, and all of a sudden I'm rich.
Like, yeah, you know, like I think to be charitable to Dan, like, I think it's more like I'm not actually this guy, but like everything that's happening to me is making me feel like, you know, everything I touch turns to gold.
Well, the Midas hand was a cautionary tale, Mr. Reynolds.
Yeah. And, you know, we'll see. It's not going to be like MC Hammer, but we're going to see a little bit of a fall for Dan as this series progresses. I think, you know, there's so many things we could talk about in terms of like the way that sounds. Like, I hate whistles in any song.
Yeah.
Like, I've never heard like a whistle and it sounds cool to me.
For me, it's Guns N' Roses, Patience. That's my only counterexample I have. Yeah, and even that one, I kind of am like, it went on too long.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. But like, they do it all. Like, like I said in the first episode of the series, like, the hand claps, the drops, the millennial. It's just like, it's not that they do one to make the song better. It's like they're doing it all the time in every verse and every chorus.
And I'm sure we'll get more chances to talk about it, but I struggled with this one, man.
Yeah.
The first one, I can at least appreciate the production skill.
Mm-hmm.
This one is too much all of the time. It's everything I hate about this band. In every song, relentlessly.
That is kind of the point that I wanted to make about Smoke and Mirrors as a whole. Now, you know, that song was produced by Alex da Kid, but actually most of this album was produced by Imagine Dragons by themselves.
I think I can tell.
Yeah.
I think I can tell.
Like, you would think that, like, with the amount of production that they have, like, you would think, oh, the producers are ruining the sound of this, like, halfway decent indie band. No, I actually think in most cases, the producers restrain what they want to do. And I've actually heard Dan in some interviews say as much. He agrees this album is overproduced.
He overdid it.
Yeah.
And it's the thing is, it's not even in a fun cocaine way, like Milli Vanilli, no. Where you're like, you know, why would you do this? It just feels like there's no restraint, like a kid in his third year of learning an instrument.
Yeah.
He's starting to get good. So he overdoes the shit out of a guitar solo. It's that, but with production.
Yeah. And maybe that is where the rock star ego does creep in. You know, it's because like before you were like just some guy, you know, getting a record deal. Now you're Dan Reynolds.
Yeah.
Like now you can like, oh, I think we should have this. I think we should, oh, turn off this. Oh, we'll put some hand claps and let's just do this, that, and the other thing.
There's not enough harmonies in this part.
Yeah. It's like, who's going to tell him no at this point? He's already had two, like, he's already been like 7 times platinum. But this album really does suffer from that. It's got a lot of issues. Like, some songs are okay, honestly, but a lot of it just feels like them not entirely sure where to take their sound and just kind of doing whatever they think might work.
Do the first one, but bigger.
Yeah, just they're throwing shit at a wall to see what sticks. And it is on Smoke and Mirrors that we find what I currently think might be the most obnoxious Imagine Dragons song to date. This is a song called I Bet My Life.
I know I took the path that you would never want for me. I know I let you down tonight. So many sleepless nights where you were waiting up on me. Well, I'm just a slave unto the night. Now remember when I told you that's the last you'll see of me. Remember when I broke it down to tears. I know I took the path that you would never want for me. I gave you hell through all the years. So why?
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm with you.
it's too much, man. It's just way too fucking much.
I think it's something about who we are both musically and culturally that makes this song nails on a chalkboard. Because this feels to me, this is like the stuff I hate the most about like church culture mixed with the stuff I hate the most about pop music culture. It's just everything I hate in music in one song.
But let's try to articulate this a bit. Like, what are the... I'm trying to figure out what it is about this song that I hate in particular. It's... And part of it is, like, you know, and they've done this trick before, so they know that it works. You have a very, like, simple strumming acoustic guitar part, you know, that's juxtaposed against these, like, gigantic turned up to 11 drums. You know, and then they add in all sorts of random, you know, noise. It's really the chorus that drives it over the top.
Yeah. Yeah, it's that. The whole thing relies on getting the crowd to feel this and sing it with you.
Yeah.
The way you would in like a church.
Oh, yeah.
They try and achieve that by maximizing every single sound. Like you said, it's the drums are way high. Everything's way high. And even that would all be all right if you had made a hook that I wanted to hear, but something on I bet my life, I bet my life. It's grating.
Your fucking 4-year-old could imagine a melody that's as good as that, you know?
Yeah, it's just really, to anyone who has made it through 5th grade band practice, this is a difficult song to internalize.
One of the problems that I have with Imagine Dragons is that their music scales up, but it doesn't scale down. Like, for example...
Yeah, if you play this at a bar, like, right, you and an acoustic guitar.
Exactly. Like, you're just like, what the fuck are you... But you know, but you could play any Elton John song, any Queen song, most Rolling Stones songs at a bar in Madison right now, and it would sound just as good as if you played it at Live Aid.
Right.
You know?
It's because there is a vocal melody at all. This doesn't have one. It's like, just a chant.
That you can't do that with Imagine Dragons. It does not scale down. You can't, like, we kind of got lucky with that Radioactive acoustic version. Like, that actually did work.
Yeah.
Like, in a weird way. But 90% of their discography just doesn't work like that. Like, this only makes sense in the context of a giant packed arena filled with tens of thousands of teens who feel the exact same way about this song that Dan does.
I just had a thought. Do you think there was a bunch of people that were like 65 when the song Cecilia by Simon and Garfunkel came out that were yelling about it. It's just a stomp clap, and he says Cecilia.
I mean,
why is this so much shittier than that? Is like the crux of my question.
That's a great question.
Because it objectively is. It is. I will figure out a scientific reason. I hate this far more than Cecilia.
If Cecilia was the only Simon and Garfunkel song that I knew, I'd probably hate that band. It's definitely among the lower tier of songs that I like by them.
Mm-hmm.
It's because I know that they're capable of so much more that I'm willing to forgive them.
I will also say they did it first.
Yeah.
When you do this 50 years prior to when this song came out, I think it's a little different. That might be part of it.
That could very well be, you know, and it could be that we're just on the wrong side of history, Cal. Like,
yeah, we're old.
It could very well be that, like, you know, people listen to this song, this podcast 50 years from now and think, like, why do these guys hate Imagine Dragons? It's classic music. Everybody knows that. The other thing about this song is that the minute that I heard it, well, I had two thoughts. First was, what fucking commercial was this
in?
Yes. You know, the second was, I guarantee that dozens of couples have used this song in their wedding.
Yes.
And like, we're not gonna like play it for you, but I actually dug up a wedding video that's on YouTube of some couple that used this fucking song in their mouth.
Even if it wasn't in the actual wedding, the photo montage they send out to their friends and family for sure. You can already, you all can picture it. I know you can.
Yeah, it's like, I don't even have to spell it out really. But in fairness to the theme of this episode, like, this song does come from a real place. And in particular, this song is about Dan Reynolds' strained relationship with his family. It's not about a lover of some kind. It's about him reconciling with his parents, essentially, you know, and, you know, and just admitting how much he relied on them and how much headaches he caused them, you know, by not being the sixth member of the Reynolds and Company law firm, you know.
I can relate. I wouldn't express it this way, but I can relate.
Oh, dude, I'm just trying to imagine if you wrote this song for your dad. I would pay money to see the look on your dad's face if you made this song for him.
I raised you on Hendrix. What are you doing?
Like, that would give him a stroke. Now, on a commercial level, Smoke and Mirrors did do respectably well, debuting at number one on the Billboard charts and remaining in the top 20 for several more weeks. But its sales still paled in comparison to Night Visions, and it failed to produce any monster hits like Radioactive or Demons. And for a guy as competitive as Dan Reynolds, this must have been seen as a major disappointment. So, after a brief hiatus in 2016, Imagine Dragons came back the following year, determined to do whatever it takes to equal the success of their debut. And, of course, by the grace of Joseph Smith, they did succeed, creating once again an album that dominated the airwaves and beamed from PAs of every sports stadium in the country. An album that took whatever rock credentials this band had in the first place and threw them into the fucking trash. It is time, at long last, to talk about 2017's Evolve.
First things first, I'ma say all the words inside my head. I'm fired up and tired of the way that things have been. Oh, ooh, the way that things have been. Oh, ooh. Second thing, second, don't you tell me what you think that I can be. I'm the one at the sail, I'm the master of my sea. Oh, ooh, the master of my sea. Oh, ooh. I was broken from a young age, taking my soak into the masses, writing my poems for the few that look at me, took to me, shook at me, feeling me, singing from heartache, from the pain, taking my message from the veins, speaking my lesson from the brain, seeing the beauty through the... Hey, you burned me up, believer, believer. Hey, you burned me up, you burned me up, believer.
Woof.
That's the juggernaut, dude. That's the one that has permeated my life against my will.
Oh, for sure. I would say, apart from Radioactive, that's probably the song that people in the audience are most likely to have heard.
Yep.
Because again, you cannot avoid this band. Yeah,
if you go to the grocery store, you probably had to hear this.
Yeah. And I consider that song to be the most Imagine Dragons-y Imagine Dragons song that exists.
Yep. It's like Tenacious D tribute or something. Yeah, it's just like the song.
Like if you have to describe to an alien what Imagine Dragons is, you pick that song. Yep. It's just, there's something about it, man. It has it all. You've got the big drums, the kind of pseudo rapping bullshit. The fucking jangly mandolin part, you got the drops, of course you got the big sing-along chorus, yep. You know. Like, it's just everything that an Imagine Dragons song like can be. It's the consummate platonic Imagine Dragons song.
I can't believe that video didn't get as big as like Gangnam Style or something. You know, it's that level of just captures everything a majority of humans want to see.
It's because people took it seriously, or no, at least enough people.
Yeah, wasn't meme-y enough.
Yeah, Gangnam Style was a meme, but like this is like a serious song by a, you know, in the eyes of many, Cal, a serious band that wins Grammys and is on the cover of Rolling Stone and like is something that in the eyes of the music industry is the fucking Beatles of our generation. So, yeah. Where might you have heard this song before if you're not an Imagine Dragons fan? You might have heard it in a Super Bowl commercial for the Nintendo Switch. You might have heard it in an ad for the Samsung Galaxy Z or WWE 2K22 or an ad for Hugo Boss cologne or in the TV shows Riverdale, Lucifer, the movie Inhumans, the movie Murder on the Orient Express.
It's horrifying.
There's an article in Vanity from 2017 that mentions that this song has been used in 32 syncs. Now, what is a sync? A sync is basically any time that a song is licensed to be combined with moving images. So that could be in a commercial. It could be in a movie trailer or a movie proper in a video game. Any time that you see some combination of images and see that song besides in the actual music video, that's a sync. And in 2017 alone, there were 32 syncs with Imagine Dragons' Believer. Well,
that's the genius of Believer. Like, have you noticed that beat, the way it goes? It is literally designed to be synced with a slow-mo action shot.
Yeah, you could.
That is right in the beat. You could put that on fucking anything. A car crash, a punch, a person jumping in a pool, like any action shot you've ever seen. You bring me up. It's right in there.
Just picture it. Picture the fucking Jeep or Range Rover driving across the landscape.
Make it go up some stupid hill right at that part.
Yep. Yeah. It's incredible.
I will give credit where it's due. The songwriting is brilliant. They have made an absolute soundtrack abomination. It could be used in anything.
Like they must have had a moment recording that where just like we're hitting our.
Do you think when that drop happens in the studio, like Dan Reynolds, he does like a Matrix movie? He's all like, "Whoa! Did you guys hear that? You got to keep that in the song. You have to keep that part."
I think he had an erection and had an instinctive urge to call his bishop about it.
Ah! Oh no! What was that?
Oh no! Oh no! I've sinned. On a more substantive level, and again, we gotta like view both sides of this. This song is a meditation by Dan Reynolds on how pain and adversity have helped him become stronger as an individual. You see, in addition to the singer's aforementioned mental health issues, Dan Reynolds also suffers from a medical condition called ankylosing spondylitis. Have you heard of this, Cal?
No.
So this is a type of arthritis that causes inflammation of the joints in the spine, especially at the point where the spine kind of meets the pelvis.
The worst spot to have inflammation
in
your whole body.
Yeah. You know, and, you know, Cal, you've had
episodes
of
a lot
of physical pain kind of like this.
It almost derailed this podcast.
Yeah. Like, so he, you know, he started suffering from this in his 20s, and it didn't get properly diagnosed for years and years. But basically, like, he's just in almost constant physical pain. He describes it as like when you go to the dentist and they drill your teeth, you just feel that in your lower back.
Yeah, I've lived this. I have my lowest disc in my back is slipped. Mm-hmm. And it's herniated out to the left and it pushes into my leg nerve. And it's just like that now. And the only way you can really control it is eat anti-inflammatory, don't drink, don't smoke, which I ignore.
You're not enough of a believer, Cal.
Right. No, I empathize with this a ton. It actually did severely derail my life for like 6 months until I got it under control.
Oh, for sure. And like, you know, just consider like, what's this guy doing? He's touring. He's like jumping around on stage, you know, like having to like suffer through it all and like just try to sing.
Dude,
radio active. Radio.
Right. Yeah. And you're sleeping on a tour bus bed every night. Yep. It would add up.
For sure. And, you know, to your point, Cal, he has had to lead a very disciplined life. Like, since he found out that this was his illness, like, he eats like nothing but like raw vegetables and like anti-inflammatory shit.
That's the thing. All the inflammatories are everything you like. It's like red meat, salt, sugar.
Yeah. Like, so like, I mean, I really pity this guy because like, I've always had a body that, by the grace of God, like everything else about me is fucked up, but my body can handle eating all sorts of shit and I've never gotten fat. You know, that's the price I pay for just being single and just completely dysfunctional in every other respect.
It was a character creator. They stat maxed you on like endurance and nothing else.
But hey, you know, maybe I'll take it. But no, he works out like obsessively. If you look at pictures of him, he's got a very athletic physique.
Yeah.
And he just like is just super rigorous about the way that he lives his life. And I'm sure that was made easier by the fact that he grew up Mormon.
Yeah.
And like, you know, he's told not to do all this shit anyway.
His dopamine receptor stayed pretty normal. He's not like the rest of us.
Yeah. But that's kind of like the emotional place where this song comes from. Like, pain, you made me a believer. Like, that's what it's all about. Now, in terms of the production of this song was produced by a couple of Swedish guys called Mattman and Robin, and they produced...
Fucking Christ.
You laugh, but these guys are like a pretty serious entity in the pop music world.
Would you call them a dynamic duo?
They are. They're like arguably bigger superheroes than the guys that they're naming themselves after. Like, these guys, prior to Imagine Dragons, they worked with Taylor Swift, Britney Spears, Jonas Brothers, Adam Lambert. Like, I could have listed like 10 other names that you'd know.
Cesar, I love the idea of naming yourself that. And then being so actually prolific that people kind of just have to be like, no, they are a dynamic duo.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, well, we called ourselves Mattman and Robin. Now we have to live up to it. And I think what they brought to Imagine Dragons was... Imagine Dragons was always a pop band. Like, they do.
Yes.
They don't have the rock and roll soul about
it. I'm not even going to pretend there's an argument. Yeah, if I hear this band called a rock band again, I'm going to freak out.
No, like, you can make a case for their earlier stuff that it had a rock flavor to it. You know, like I said, they have the presentation of a rock band. They take the form of a rock band, but they're not a fucking rock band.
No.
And I think these guys helped Imagine Dragons realize that because Evolve is a pop, capital P, pop album.
Yep.
And like, I'm not saying that's bad necessarily. It's just like, it's not what we like, but it's clearly what they were going for all along.
It's like what people had to figure out with Ghost. Like, there was so much debate for the longest time if Ghost is metal. And I would argue they never were. They took the visuals, they took the vibe of it and did something else with it.
And it was a genius move because like, that's all we do in capitalism.
Oh, they're
like,
the only relevant metal, quote, band right now.
There are goth chicks walking around this earth today that have never heard of Bauhaus or The Cure, you know, and that's by design. You know, everything becomes a fashion statement at some point or time.
Yep.
But one of the things you notice with this album is like, to the extent that there was any instrumentation, like at all. Like, it's just, it's even less on this album. And it's, on the one hand, I feel bad for Wayne Sermon, Ben McKee, Daniel Platzman, the backing band of the Dan Reynolds project. On the one hand, I feel like they're getting kind of screwed here. But I also noticed that they get songwriting credits on every single Imagine Dragons song, along with the producer and Dan, usually. And you just wonder, like, is this part of the deal with the devil, you know? Yeah. Like, this is all my own theory. This is like,
I'll pretend you did something.
I'm not speaking for them. I don't know what happens in the studio. All I know is the product that actually comes out,
right.
and what the ingredients are, and like, how does, like, it's just like, if you put sugar and flour and chocolate chips and butter into a dish and you put it in the oven and it comes out a souffle. It doesn't make sense.
Right.
You know?
Well, and I just think if the bass line is bump, 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 should you really get a writing credit? Because, you know, no, I'm with you. And I'm not, as we've went out of our way to express, like, the guy can do more.
Oh, yeah,
that's
for
not
sure.
The issue. It's what he's being asked to do. I have to agree with you. You put him in there as a writing credit just so he feels something in his dead soul.
Not just feels something, but earns millions and millions of dollars.
Yeah.
You know, I once listened to a podcast with Billy Corgan. And, you know, he had kind of a similar relationship to Smashing Pumpkins, where, like, they're a band, they're a unit, but, like, he is the guy writing all the songs. And he is the face of the band, especially as they become big and he gets all the attention. Initially, he wanted to, like, share songwriting credits with the whole band, but someone kind of got in his ear and just kind of told him, like, no, you're writing the songs. Put Billy Corgan on the credits. And so he got gazillions of dollars when Smashing Pumpkins got big, and the other guys got kind of a pittance, and that bred a lot of resentment inside Smashing Pumpkins that you could argue derailed their career as a band. And I think Dan Reynolds kind of learned from that mistake, maybe because he's got lawyer brothers who can tell him, hey,
keep them happy.
Keep them satiated. Like, you know, it'll cost you $10 million here or there, but you'll have a band that's going to last a lot longer.
That is the classic, do you maximize profit or do you keep your employees happy? One's a long-term investment and one is a short.
Yeah. And I think, you know, if that is the calculus that Dan Reynolds made, it is, to me, unquestionably the right one.
Yes, totally agree.
But this is what Evolve is, and it is an evolution for them. Like, it's actually
for
pretty
better or worse.
It is an apt
the name
title.
Devo was already taken, so we're going evolution.
Yeah, and you know, like, just I think, like we said, like, this is everything us, the old geezers.
Yes.
You know, like,
this is what we rallied against, man.
Yeah, this is everything that is just like the opposite of music to our ears.
Yep.
And I think the song where that kind of over the top, like, just obnoxious anthemic bullshit reaches its peak is there's one singular track that just rises above all the others in terms of how absurd it fucking is, and that is the song Thunder.
Thunder. Thunder. Kids were laughing in my classes while I was scheming for the masses. Who do you think you are? Dreaming about being a big star. They say you're basic, they say you're easy, you're always riding in the backseat. Now I'm smiling from the stage while you were clapping in the nosebleeds.
Thunder, 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 thunder,
thunder, thunder, thunder, thunder, thunder,
thunder,
thunder, feel the thunder, lightning and the thunder, thunder, feel the thunder.
Yeah.
Thunder. Be the thunder.
I hate the word thunder now all of a sudden. I can't explain it.
You know, I have a lot to say about this song, Cal. But where I'll start is, to me, that song actually crosses what I'm going to call the Vitaly threshold. Now, this is the point where a song is so bad, so ridiculous, that I actually kind of have an ironic appreciation for it. Yeah. Like, I think this song is kind of fun to listen to because it's just, there's no way I could possibly take it seriously. It's just like, how do you just wake up, go to the studio, make that song, and then like fucking high five everyone that you know?
It like, feels like doing your lab report in the last 5 minutes and then you somehow get an A and you're like, whoa, what the fuck?
So I'm a fucking genius, bro.
I just said thunder like 800 times and he accepted it. I don't
And then you like, it's like, oh no, wait, guys, what if we put like a little chipmunk vocal you know, on the backing track?
It's like, does anything rhyme with thunder?
It's like, okay,
no,
sure.
No, not really. Let's just say thunder over and over a bunch of times.
It's like, can we tell Dan how much this sucks? No, come on, guys. He's made us millions of dollars. God damn it.
Why would we lose faith now?
I enjoy that song and for all the wrong reasons. And you know who else enjoys it? I got my two-year-old nephew hooked on this song.
But that's telling. I did. It's adult Barney music. It really is. Like,
I actually did this on purpose. And, you know, to my sister, if you're listening, I'm sorry. This is
part of your life now, too.
It is. But she's also used to it. She, you know, like she, you know, before this, it was Baby Shark. So, you know.
We're moving up.
Yeah, we're moving up a little bit. I actually tried to do this earlier with Tub Thumping, like, because I wanted to see, okay, that's a very simple song with a very easy to memorize hook. If I play that for him a couple of times, will it take? And it kind of didn't. He didn't really respond to that.
Yeah, you just got
to
get him at the right time.
But I played this song like two or three times and he was like immediately hooked. He's like, now whenever I babysit, he goes, watch Thunder, Thunder. And he fucking sings the whole song. Like,
I have graduated my son, finally. We're into Daft Punk and Beastie Boys.
Yep.
We're honestly in the best era of my musical life with this child right now.
Your son is a 90s cool kid. You got to get him a No Fear t-shirt and some Mountain Dew Code Red.
He does wear a lot of like Nike shit.
Get him the fucking one with the Looney Tunes where Bugs and the Tasmanian Devil like folding their arms and shit.
I think he does have a Space Jam shirt. I'm not even kidding.
Nice. I love this song for so many reasons. This is also like an important point in our story because, you know, as longtime listeners of this podcast know, every bad band reaches a point where they write their Fuck the Critics song.
Mm-hmm.
And this isn't the first Fuck the Critics song from Imagine Dragons that we're going to hear, but, or it's not the only one, but it is the first one. And with this one, they're literally just saying like, they say you're basic. They say you're easy, which, Dan, we do.
I'm going to write a song proving that beyond a shadow of a doubt.
Which, like, but his answer is not that they're not basic. It's that, oh, yeah, well, I'm a millionaire now.
Right. Apparently, everyone likes this and everything I touch is gold.
Yeah. Like, just like, you know, it's like his whole response is like, what are you going to do about it?
It is like a guy who like stumbled into just an untapped gold mine. He's like, oh, all I had to do was a stomp clap beat the whole time.
Like, just, yeah, look how much fucking gold I'm swimming. I love it. He's like the fucking Elon Musk of musicians. Another thing I love is, again, going back to the website Genius, there's no need to annotate this song. There's no hidden references to James Joyce or whatever. But like, for some reason, every fucking line of this song is annotated. You know, like just the opening lyrics. A simple description of what he wants is shown here through a metaphor. A young gun with a quick fuse. This represents a hungry and eager person ready to take on the world and follow their own path. It seems as if this person is not comfortable with their current situation, which can be shown in the lyrics, "Wanna leave my own life behind."
I love that they have to explain the phrase, "Wanna leave my own life behind."
This is
what,
like,
could that mean?
This is like some like seventh grader uses ChatGPT to write a book report, you know?
It actually literally reminds me, when we were in seventh grade, the song Kryptonite by Third Eye Blind was big.
No, by Theodore's Down.
Yeah, and that was one of the options. We had to analyze song lyrics as like an assignment, and they gave us all these options. That was the only one from like that year, so of course everyone jumped on that.
Sure, yeah.
And it was like as in doing it, I realized how fucking stupid the song Kryptonite was.
It's like, oh, he's saying he's not Superman,
right? You
know, because he's failing. Oh, wow. It's like you have like this moment of realization that like, oh, this is kind of dumb, yeah. Isn't it?
That might have been the start of my music snobbery.
Yeah.
Now that I dig into this, that assignment.
Yeah. This is dumb. So, like, here we are now. Like, this is what I'm going to call peak Imagine Dragons. Like, we're in 2017. This album is a massive success. This one, like, goes 3x platinum. Both of the songs that we just played become top 10 hits. And, like, it reaches a point where in March of 2018, Imagine Dragons become the first band in history to monopolize the top 4 slots of Billboard's, quote, alternative digital song sales charts. What the exact parameters of that, like, I don't care even enough to look into, but if you were Googling in March of 2018, you know, Billboard's top alternative digital song sales, the first 4 songs in that list would be Thunder, followed by Whatever It Takes, followed by Next to Me, which is also Imagine Dragons, which is followed by Believer. All 4 from the same fucking album. It's like they just like whatever it means to be a rock band, whatever it means to be an alternative rock band or whatever it is they are, Imagine Dragons are commercially the best at yep. it at yep. this point. It actually reminds me, Cal, of there was one point in like 1964, and I'm not comparing Imagine Dragons to the Beatles, but
I'm about to compare them.
But there was a moment where the Beatles had like literally the top 5 songs on the Billboard charts were all Beatles songs.
Now, let me ask you this. Maybe you'll know off the top of your head or not. Was that early era Beatles?
This is like peak Beatlemania. This is like right before A Hard Day's Night.
Okay. So that actually is a fair comparison then.
Yeah.
The most vapid form of the Beatles is when they dominated the chart. And what we've now looked back on and recognize as their best era was not the dominant era.
Oh, for sure. Like, although I will say, I'll still listen to early Beatles.
Like, I like it. Yeah, like I'm with you.
And it works. Like, it's not going to like blow your head off musically, but like the harmonies are fucking solid.
Yeah.
But hey, you know, maybe I'm just foreshadowing the point where Dan Reynolds makes his own Sergeant Pepper.
I was just going to say, we joked about this with Nickelback. What if they went completely off the edge?
I don't know, Cal. I guess our listeners will have to stay tuned for part 3 to find out.
Spoiler alert. They didn't.
Yeah. And so obviously, like, not only like is it the point where the fans, the fire breathers are like loving Imagine Dragons more than ever, but this is the point where like they've reached their commercial peak, right? Like this is like the point where, as we've already mentioned multiple times, you cannot go to a public place that plays music without hearing Imagine Dragons. And one thing that I find telling about this particular time period is all along as I'm digging up articles about Imagine Dragons, interviews, etc., like in the beginning, the very beginning, they're written up in like local, like Las Vegas zines, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then like Radioactive comes out, and then they're in Rolling Stone, they're in Billboard. But starting around like 2017, you see articles about them in like Forbes
yeah.
and Business Insider.
We're not even hiding it anymore.
It's like they've made so much money and they've made so much profit for other corporations that like the oligarchs of America are like finally starting to take notice.
No, and this is when you know you've lost. Like you're the music purists have lost.
Oh yeah.
It's not about art anymore. No matter what Dan claims, it's not about art anymore. You're a juggernaut, man. If you make a song and it makes it in the next Ford commercial, you're a business asset. You're not an artist.
He could want to make a Revolution 9 type song. Or he could want to make an I Am the Walrus, but like 10,000 right. different people in suits are going to be trying to push him to like dumb it down and make it like, we can't.
How can I sell Mountain Dew if you don't fucking, you're giving me stuff like this?
No, it's like, you know, you feel bad for him in that sense. So yeah, corporate America is finding really increasingly clever ways to incorporate Imagine Dragons into whatever they're trying to fucking push, right? And one thing that I find interesting is this thing that happens during the 2015 Grammys, where Target, the big retail chain that, you know, wants to brainwash all your kids into being gay, so I'm told, they bought out an entire commercial break slot at the Grammys. So, like, you watch the Grammys and it goes to quote unquote commercial, but the commercial, quote unquote, is just Imagine Dragons playing a song.
That, oh, God, that's so fucking weird.
It is.
Here's a song you like. And then at the very end, Target.
Yeah. It's just like, well, it's like they're playing the song brought to you by Target. And then you have like this like Target hashtag.
It's like what Wayne's World was warning us.
Yeah. It really. Yeah. But like unself-aware. And I'm not even blaming Imagine Dragons for this. Like, this is just like another thing for them to do. So this little stunt they did, you know, and Imagine Dragons performs the song Shots, you know, in Las Vegas, at, you know, as part of this Grammy thing. Target paid $8 million for that, like to produce that whole thing. Like, unless the logic of corporate America is wrong, Target got more than $8 million worth of revenue somehow out of using Imagine Dragons in this way.
That is insane.
Now, one Billboard article from 2017 highlights some of the behind-the-scenes maneuvers that kind of helped push Imagine Dragons along in this way. You see, speaking about the band's dealings with streaming services, an executive vice president from Interscope, their record label, he commented, quote, "We met with all three partners, Spotify, Apple Music, and Amazon, separately on a single day, with the band in fact playing music, talking about long-term strategy. It's a great collaboration between creative and marketing. That's how you win."
I love that we live in an era where this can be said out loud and it's not career suicide for a band.
No, it doesn't hurt their brand one bit.
Yeah,
it
nobody
doesn't...
gives a I actually think the youngest generation views bands and music as product.
No, they get excited when you know, when their band is used for a commercial, yeah, or some shit. Like, it's just, that's where, you know, as much as we rip on boomers, they were right about
shit. Yeah.
Like, they look at this and they feel even more revulsed than we do, because Willie Nelson in the 80s, like, got massively criticized for doing a Taco Bell commercial. The only reason he did that was because he was in debt to the IRS. but it was like a hugely bad career move for him. And like a lot of bands, like, got massively shat upon anytime they like even flirted with the idea of doing a commercial.
Dude, can you think about now, like nowadays, if you put Willie Nelson in a Taco Bell commercial, how viral you could get that?
Oh, make, yeah.
It'd be his last hurrah. It'd be the last time anyone knew who he was.
Yeah. It's like, oh, you know, obviously, if you did that and didn't mention weed, like somehow, like I would think that would be an achievement. If you could.
You'd have to have him like get out of a car and smoke comes out, but you never reference why that happened. And then you go into, you have to do something like low key that you think you can get away with.
Yeah. So that quote implies that Dan and the guys were in the room playing music, you know, saying like, no, this is like, this song would be great for this playlist or that playlist.
Yeah.
Like, you know, so
we wrote this to be in this commercial. Why do you think we're sitting in this room with you?
Yeah. And everybody's like fine with it. And, you know, and it's also ironic that in the room in these conversations is a guy, Mac Reynolds, the manager, who once wrote a prize-winning essay arguing that music should be socialized.
Ugh.
Everyone's a fucking sellout, man. Now, like, literally, though, like, I'm not trying to say that Imagine Dragons are sellouts. Now, why do I say that? Because they've never taken like any explicit stand against like corporate America, against capitalism.
You.
Like they're not Rage Against the Machine.
No, yeah.
You know?
You have to be a rock band in the first place to be able to be accused of selling out.
Yeah. No, like just Imagine Dragons, there's nothing in the whole canon of their music that suggests really any kind of rebellion against anything.
You're telling me this guy who went to BYU isn't a badass who wants to fight the system?
No, it's not like something that they would even consider, or most of their fans would even think about. You know, they'd have to do something really egregious to get their fans pissed off at them.
Well, and that's where it goes back to White Will.i.am, as much as I hate to keep going back to it. It's,
yeah.
When you start the band, if they're measuring success off of how much art down the road do we influence, if that was never the goal, mm-hmm. if the actual measure of success is how popular are we and how much money are we making,
yeah,
they're just operating on a different rule set than traditional rock and roll.
Yeah. And here's the other reason that I'm going to give them a little bit of slack. It's that, like, in the 80s, you know, in the 90s, you could make just CDs, just LPs, and do fine as a band. You might, some of them might not even have toured, you know.
Mm-hmm.
In 2017, that is impossible. These guys make, like, maybe at most 10% of their money from record sales. Everything else comes from touring and licensing. Yep. Like, you, if you want to survive as a musician, you have to get your song in a commercial of some sort. Like, that just is how it fucking works. So, yeah, that's right. Why Imagine Dragons is the way it is.
Yeah, getting mad at them is kind of like getting mad at, like, the symptoms of your cancer.
Exactly. The only thing I wonder is, like, why does it work so fucking well with Imagine Dragons? Why does every advertiser, like, I never took any marketing classes in college, Cal. I never went to business school. I assume that all of these guys are privy to some, like, dark book of satanic rituals where they know how to penetrate the depths of the human psyche and get us to, like, buy whatever fucking, you know, ridiculous, like, Chinese produced piece of crap they want to sell. And they know that Imagine Dragons produces the exact combination of sounds in the particular key and rhythm that it takes to sell the most things to the most people. I just want to know the mechanics of why.
They sold their soul to the Mormon devil. It's the spooky Mormon hell dream in the musical.
Maybe it comes from the golden plates, Cal. Maybe there's something in the subtext
that
of this
was Moroni's last thing. And Joseph, by the way, do you want to sell millions of records?
Exactly.
Here's the secret.
Listen to me very closely. Pass this down to the generations.
And if you add but a single note, it will not work.
Okay, so we've spent most of this episode trashing Imagine Dragons and kind of implying that, like, they're puppets of corporate America, which, not that they are, but, like, their music just is.
Yeah.
You know? But I thought it would at least be fair to end this episode on a positive note, because as obnoxious as this band was during the mid-2010s, not everything Dan Reynolds did was evil. Because indeed, it was during this time period that Dan Reynolds, to paraphrase Marge Simpson, began to give back to society after taking so much away. Now, before we talk about Dan's philanthropic efforts, it's worth coming back to his Mormon upbringing for a second. You see, Cal, the Church of Latter-day Saints, it has a lot of controversial beliefs, mm-hmm. shall we say. But one of the most consequential things it teaches concerns its attitudes towards LGBT people. And can you perhaps summarize to our audience right. what that attitude is?
Yeah, because every other church is so much more progressive on this.
Well,
yeah.
Okay.
But it's bad.
Yeah.
I think every major religion, their attitude towards this is bad.
Not all. I mean, there are, you know, there are branches of Christianity that have come around a lot on this issue. But
is it a Unitarian?
No, the Episcopalians, you know, split on this. Like, there are branches of Methodism that, to take a weird side note, like, Methodism, the entire Methodist church literally just split over this. I know this because my sister's a Methodist and her church dissolved because of, like, infighting over this specific issue.
That's insane. All right, keep going.
But, like, yeah, but, like, they split, the entire church fucking split over the question of whether to allow, like, gay ministers and gay weddings and shit. The only other time this happened was twice before, actually. The first was over slavery in the 1800s. The second was over civil rights.
Damn.
So, like,
that's insane.
Yeah. But, okay, so a lot of Christianity has a bad take on gay rights and gay marriage and shit like that. But what's kind of unique about Mormonism is that they kind of have a slightly different take on it. Baptists and Catholic churches, what they try to tell gay people is that, like, no, it's not, it's a choice, and you're just like, you know,
it's a perversion you're partaking in.
Yeah, it's a perversion, and you're doing it because you're a sinner, and you're just making a bad choice, and you're not doing what everybody else should be doing. You know, it's like comparable to like a drug addiction.
Right, and that, yeah, that's how they like equate it to fucking dogs and stuff. They're looking at it as a bad behavior, not a who you are.
Yeah. Whereas with Mormonism, they've kind of come around to saying that they acknowledge that, okay, you are born this way, but you should still be straight anyway.
It's your curse.
Yeah. Like, I mean, it's almost literally, they, it's like, not your curse, they'd call it your burden.
Right. It's like being born with like cerebral palsy or something to them.
No, like they literally, like, they talk about encouraging what they call mixed orientation couples, which is literally just like a gay guy and a lesbian get together, force themselves to have sex, birth a bunch of babies, raise those babies in the Mormon church, and just everything's gonna be fine.
Yeah, you know, I play a game called Crusader Kings, mm-hmm. where you have to like protect your lineage in medieval Europe.
Yeah,
this exact thing happens. Your heir will be gay, and every now and then you'll get a champ who just, he kicks out like six kids, and you know he hated every minute of it, but he does it for the team.
It's like, come on, man. Just And shoe on the other foot, Cal. Imagine if you were forced into that kind of arrangement the rest of your life.
I think about that all the time. One of the best sex help column answers I ever saw, I saw this in a meme. Some old lady wrote into some sex help column in the newspaper about like her daughter's gay. Mm-hmm. She doesn't understand why she's choosing this lifestyle. And all the lady wrote back to her was, well, why don't you choose to be gay for a week to understand how it feels?
Yeah.
You know, and that's just such a case in point of like, it's obviously not a choice. Like,
yeah.
Duh. It's so obvious. Think about converting yourself right now. Would it work? Fuck no.
Yeah, exactly. And it's just, it's such a simple and true. Like,
you change tonight.
Yeah.
See how that feels? All right, we're done. What's this argument?
Exactly. And we can kind of laugh about this shit because on a certain level, it's so ridiculous. It is kind of funny, but it's also very serious because the church's intolerance, it has a direct, literally empirically measurable effect on LGBT youth. And, you know, spoiler alert, it's not a pretty picture. And here we're going to do like the very rare and probably unnecessary thing. I'm going to issue a trigger warning here because we're going to have to talk about, you know, prematurely ending one's own life, you know, because that's like literally the subject of what charitable efforts that Dan is going to get into here. So suicide is a very common thing for LGBT youth, and it's especially common in Mormon families. Utah, the hotbed of Mormonism, has one of the highest suicide rates in the country. In 2017, suicide was the leading cause of death for children aged 10 to 17. You know, one study from the year before found that the LDS's churches, their stance on homosexuality directly contributed to these high suicide rates. And it's just not hard to picture why.
No, yeah, like, that shouldn't be surprising.
Yeah, like you're in an age that's very difficult to be in general. And you're starting to feel feelings that you've been told your whole life are wrong, and you're told that you're weird and you got to get over it and you got to fix yourself, and you literally can't do that. Some people just like are driven to the ultimate extreme by that.
Well, it's your family telling you, we view this as a disability, and our solution and support to you is, have you tried not being disabled?
Yeah.
That's the best they've got.
Yeah. And
you would feel like you have nobody in your life in that scenario.
Yeah. And so like, even when it doesn't end in death, it almost always leads to, you know, PTSD, major depressive order, like a whole slew of mental health issues. So it's a really unfortunate thing. Now, even though Dan Reynolds himself isn't gay, he has been a vocal and proud supporter of the LGBT community. And this is directly related to Dan's kind of quasi-rebellion against his Mormon upbringing. So why does he choose this as his pet cause? It's because it hits close to home for him. Like, as soon as Imagine Dragons becomes a popular band after Radioactive. Dan Reynolds is instantly one of the like highest profile Mormons in the country. You start to read articles in like, you know, Mormon magazines about like, hey, did you know the lead singer of the hottest new band is a Mormon? You know?
Mm-hmm.
So like he's getting all these letters from Mormons, and he starts to also get letters, emails and shit from kids who were Mormon and gay. And he's reading these the letters from these kids, and they have all these conflicted feelings, and they're like asking him for guidance, you know, or just like just writing to him about their struggle and how horrible they feel, just because like maybe they feel like they've got no one else to talk to.
It is that.
Yeah. No one in their family is going to support them. Like,
he's,
you know,
the closest thing to a cool guy they know.
Yeah. And like they're emotionally connecting to his music, and like, so they're turning to him, and this Dan's maybe a bit of an empath. This affects him very profoundly. He basically decides, you know, like I'm getting shades of Bob Geldof here, but he's going to do something about it.
Hell yeah.
So Dan starts this charity called Love Loud. It actually starts out as a music festival. This is going to be a charity concert designed to raise funds for various LGBT-related charities. In its inaugural press release, Dan or his team writes, Love Loud was founded to help ignite the relevant and vital conversation of what it means to unconditionally love, understand, accept, and support the LGBT plus Q youth in an effort to keep families together. Love Loud is the catalyst for bringing communities together to start the conversation and celebrate individuality. This first Love Loud festival was held in Orem, Utah. Like they very deliberately set it in Utah.
Mm-hmm.
And it was attended by like 17,000 people. And I don't know how much money they raised, but it was a lot. And they raised money for groups like GLAAD, the Trevor Project, Stand for Kind, a few others. And the unfortunate thing, Cal, is that most of this money ended up in the hands of an African warlord who used it to pursue his own genocidal... No, don't worry.
I would say the saddest part is there is like a part of me that was like, really? Because it's happened so often.
No, we have PTSD from Live Aid, you know. But no, this... I did look into all these organizations just to make sure that none of them were problematic in that way. Like, I could kind of get into it, but like... GLAAD is like this anti-defamation lobby. They like basically try to influence Hollywood to have more gay representation in their, you know, TV shows. Like GLAAD is basically the reason why like not every gay character you see in a sitcom isn't like, hey, like just like.
Well, why? How did they miss the mark so bad in Modern Family? Holy shit.
I don't.
Hey, a side rant. We've been rewatching all of that.
I haven't seen Modern Family.
Why did they make Cam and Mitch the worst? It's not even that they're gay. It's they're the most manipulative, unfunctional two humans I've ever seen as a couple in a sitcom. They can barely get through their daily life, and every plot line is them lying to each other and then resolving it in some hilarious way, and it gets exhausting. All right, rant over.
Well, you know, maybe it's because like they're, I don't know much about the show, but they are the focal point of that show, right?
No, it's more like there's like three units within the overarching family that all get their own plot line every episode.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole family's terrible. You don't realize it until you think about it too hard.
Well, maybe that's the key, is that like if they're all terrible and one of them is gay and terrible, that's fine. You know. But it's not like, you know, like remember that like fashion designer on that Hannah Montana
episode? Yeah, it's not
like that. It's not just like a blatant stereotype. No.
The joke is never that they're gay.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's the key, is that, and like I guarantee you that the producers of that show met with somebody from GLAAD point. Every TV show does this. So that's GLAAD. The Trevor Project is like this organization that provides counseling for, you know, troubled gay youth, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Like, long story short, these organizations, as far as I can tell, are legit. I think what Dan really wanted, he's not trying to like say F you to the Mormon church. He really, truly does want them to change the way they look at gay people.
Yeah, I think so. Because A, it's a nice thing to do. And B, you get a ton of street cred with gay and lesbian people in the process.
Which is not a bad thing. Again, Dan Reynolds is a man of his times.
Yeah.
Like, he goes with the flow. Not necessarily in a cynical sense, but like
no, just, yeah, it's like every YouTube influencer right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's just part of a bigger tapestry here.
Absolutely. And, like, the idea of getting the church to change its policy towards gay people isn't maybe necessarily as chaotic as you might think, because if you know anything about the history of the Mormon church, they have changed a lot of their more controversial beliefs over time as it became clear that, that it was so socially unacceptable that it was holding them back. For example, they were famously into polygamy until that such time as they were trying to get Utah admitted into the Union. And the one thing the U.S. government explicitly told them was, you have to give up polygamy.
Knock that shit off.
And they did.
I'm just going to do it quietly now.
Yeah, well, yeah, they basically, yeah. But, you know, the prophet of the quote unquote prophet of the Mormon church, which is like their pope, he had a revelation that suddenly God no longer wants them to do polygamy anymore. So they stopped doing polygamy.
Turns out God is great timing for exactly what we want, because God showed up today.
God has magnificent timing for this church, because in 1978, after a literal, like over a century of them arguing that black people were cursed by God, you know, suddenly just, you know, just coincidentally after a couple decades of civil rights marches, God told the prophet of the church that black people were cool now. It's amazing how that works. But what's like, but the key here is that the Catholic Church doesn't have this. The Baptist Church doesn't have this. Their shit is more or less set in stone.
Right.
Whereas Mormonism has this kind of get out of jail free card.
It's like a modern cult. You got to be adaptable. You got to change with the times.
Exactly. And like, this may be what allows Mormonism to perhaps eventually eclipse regular Christianity someday.
I think it will.
Totally. Now still, as nice as all of this seems, Love Loud was not without a tiny bit of controversy. See, shortly before the inaugural event, the LDS Church reached out to Dan Reynolds and issued a press release that tepidly endorsed the project, saying, quote, "Our mission is to save the lives of LGBTQ young people. That shouldn't be a controversial statement, regardless of your religious background."
We just do it with electroshock therapy.
It's a bit shady. It just like, it reminds me of like every politician that stood with Black Lives Matter and then like goes off to like fund another police budget increase. You know, right.
Have you ever dealt with a narcissist in your personal life?
Yeah.
It's like that. I've been trying to do the right thing the whole time.
Oh yeah, for sure. Like, it's very political. And this didn't really sit well with everybody who was involved in Love Loud. And one of the people who particularly objected was a guy named Tyler Glenn. Tyler Glenn is the lead singer of the band Neon Trees. So Tyler was also a Mormon from Utah. And he's also gay, crucially. He came out and he was subsequently like excommunicated by the LDS Church. So he's got a well-justified chip on his shoulder about all this shit. This caused him a ton of anguish. Like, he was a full-believing Mormon.
Right.
You know, until they basically shunned him for just literally being what he is.
Sure, and it's, you were trying to save my life when you kicked me out of the only thing I ever knew?
Yeah. You know, so he was a little bit pissed by this. He called it a PR move, which it absolutely is. But Dan Reynolds, like, he really welcomed this LDS endorsement. It was like really a validation of what he was trying to accomplish the whole time. He said that it was powerful and progressive in a lot of ways.
I just scoff because I truly believe he truly believed this.
I do too.
He took it at face value, because based off the fact that I secretly think Dan Reynolds believes in all the music he makes.
Yeah.
He is a basic man at the end of the day.
He is. Like, Dan Reynolds, I think, is a people pleaser.
Yep.
He wants everyone to like
him. It's a golden retriever personality.
He is.
Oh, you guys say you're cool now? That's great. He's not thinking about it that hard.
100%. And I can understand a little bit where he's coming from, because if the goal is to bring people together, then you bring people together. It's like,
yeah,
it's kind of like Obama's presidency.
Yeah,
like,
and as much as I'm ragging on the guy, you do need people like this that are just relentlessly positive and trusting and genuinely just assume everyone's trying to do the best thing.
Mm-hmm.
If the world didn't have these people and it was full of cynical assholes like me, we'd have a problem.
Yeah, you know, I think you need the yin and the yang.
You need
diplomats, like people who want to bring both sides together. But you also, if you really want to change the conversation, what you have to do is push the Overton window a little bit. And that requires making people uncomfortable, and which requires saying essentially, fuck you.
Yeah.
Because like, this is an issue like where it's very, I think, clear cut. Like, it's not, he's not like trying to like argue for a Middle East peace solution or something. Like, this is like a pretty just obvious, like, these people deserve rights. What they're doing is not a sin. End of argument. You've got to just get the other side to realize that. And you're not going to do that without just saying, I'm sorry, but you're wrong.
Right.
So I didn't have this in the script, Cal, but I want to kind of pivot to this scene from HBO made a documentary about the making of this festival. It is called Believer, you know?
It was just sitting there. They had to take it.
Yeah, they had to. It's honestly not a very interesting documentary. So you're not going to get the full Nick Vitale movie review.
Yeah, I thought that we should do this festival, and I did it. And we got to fill 2 hours somehow.
I was way more entertained watching the Hannah Montana movie than I was
movie.
But there was one scene that I actually was like interested in. This is a scene where Dan has decided he's going to do this thing, and he's in his kitchen, in his home, talking to his wife about like what kind of tone they want to have for this festival and how kind of quote unquote preachy they should be.
I'm thinking food, and really what I should be thinking is, how do we not offend 50% of the people that come?
You're just trying to enlighten people. You're not trying to offend anyone.
See what you just said right there? Enlighten people. That
you think that's
says
offensive?
To people, you're in the dark. Let me enlighten you.
No. Educate.
You're stupid. Let me educate.
No, that's not true. I think people don't know statistics. They don't know the reality of what's happening.
You can't come in and say you're wrong.
No.
You have to come in and say, let's talk and believe in the goodness of people.
You have to change people's minds as
but
a friend.
But it's not even that.
You
don't have to change people's minds. They have to change their minds. We have to, like, in my opinion, it's like, the Mormon, this is where I was raised, Mormonism. So this is my community, these are my people. That's the last thing they want to do, is to say, I'm right, you're wrong, come and let me tell you why. It needs to be, everybody come to the table and let's see what's happening. These are the people who are in it, you know?
Yeah.
Their message is 10 times more powerful than me getting up. Hey, I'm the singer of Imagine Dragons. You know that song? Radioactive, radioactive. Now, let me tell you everything that I know about this subject, because I really don't know that much. And everybody's going to be like, I'm all heart. The education is yet to come. So.
Yeah, what do you think of that, Cal?
Stupid, likable ass Mormons.
he really is like the embodiment of a stereotypical Mormon. Like,
you want to go in there and be like, you fucking dork, I hate everything about it. And then he's so nice, you can't help just get won over slowly.
Like, I just like, what's it gonna take to get this guy mad?
Yeah.
Like, what would I have to say to Dan Reynolds to like get him to punch me in the face?
You could walk up to him and be like, your mom has a stupid fucking face, and be like, okay, interesting opinion. Let's talk about that.
I'm honestly kind of conflicted, like, because I think they're both right. You know, like, you do have to upset the apple cart a little bit. But Dan knows that if you take it too far, they're just going to, like, harden themselves.
Yeah, I've learned the hard way just through, like, social media shit. The average American hates getting told their own opinion.
Yeah.
you cannot sit there and give them stats and expect them to be like, oh, wow, I never thought about it like that. It's
yeah,
that is 1 in 100 people that will give you that.
No, we've learned this in the internet age. That has like been the lesson about humanity that we have learned is like how difficult it is yep. to like give facts to people and get them to change their minds.
What's even worse too is then you start getting frustrated and you start going like, "Look, you fucking idiot!"
Yeah,
and now you
and then,
now
that's you're done. That's over.
It's
yeah.
done. You're just arguing.
Yeah, but I do think like his wife has a point where you just at some point you do have to find a way like. Strike the right tone, but like you do have to say that like this is an essential truth.
Right. This is fucking fact. Stop arguing me on dumb shit.
Yeah. Like, you know, and they will resist at first, but maybe you have to play the long game. Long term, people will, under the right circumstances, come to the right belief. And I think where it's hard for Dan is that, like he says, these are his people. Like he really... As much as he's like struggled with Mormonism and like probably in his own head realized that it's fake, you know, maybe, mm-hmm. but like he really has an emotional connection to this community, this people, this tradition, and he doesn't have it in him to say, fuck you. There's nothing in Imagine Dragons that's punk rock. There's nothing right. in Imagine Dragons that's trying to make people uncomfortable besides unintentionally us, you know, but like the goal of this music, this project is to make as many human people smile as possible.
Yep.
And he's just trying to bring that persona to activism. Like Love Loud, I can't say for sure like, whether or not it changed the conversation. In Mormonism, like we're still waiting for them to like fully come around. Like they've made some baby steps here and there,
mm.
but like they still technically regard it as a sin. And, but you know, this festival, like they did it in 2017, they did it again in 2018 and 2019, and then kind of COVID derailed it a little bit, you know, but it was a thing and Dan did it. And, you know, definitely no genocides were committed as a result.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I would say at the very least, we can say it wasn't a net bad. We know that.
Yeah. And again, to circle back to our theme, you could maybe say that. Oh, Dan is just picking a cause that is easy
yeah.
for him.
Like, guarantees him lots of fans.
Guarantees him lots of fans, is in step with the times, more or less. But I really think, I think that he is sincere in this. And he chose Mormonism and chose to talk. He didn't, like, this isn't like an LGBT event for their rights. This is a... specifically to try to change the conversation within Mormonism,
right.
which I actually kind of like.
Yeah.
It's not Bob Geldof going to Ethiopia.
Right.
You know, it is a guy who knows all about Mormonism, you know, trying to fix the one bad thing that he perceives about his religion. And maybe if I have one beef with Love Loud, it's the very implication that the gay thing is the one bad thing about Mormonism that they need to fix. Like, other than that, everything's fine.
Right. No, yeah. If you want, like, 6 gay husbands, that's fine.
Yeah. It's like, yeah, maybe just allow queer kids to be comfortable with themselves. And also maybe, you know, if a guy goes to college and he had sex with his girlfriend once, like, maybe kind of give him a slide,
don't
you know?
Don't kick him out.
No. Now, good on Dan. He did a good thing. We at Polishing Turds salute him. But one thing was clear. By the late 2010s, the power of Imagine Dragons could not be denied. After just a few years, they had gone from an obscure Las Vegas curiosity to a musical juggernaut, generating untold millions for corporate America. Their music was etched into the hearts of millions of kids, and their advocacy may well have saved a lot of those kids from self-harm. It's entirely likely that Imagine Dragons has saved lives.
As much
shit as we desperately want to give them, it's probably every shit thing we say against them in this podcast is negated by
right.
little Tyler who is alive because of Imagine Dragons. I gotta keep it real.
I will rip on them for being Dorcases day and yes. night, but I wouldn't undo them from existence.
Yes. But as Cyrus the Great, and by which I mean Billy Ray Cyrus, would remind us, every action inspires an equal and opposite reaction. And with a band as big as Imagine Dragons, surely even the most untrained eye could see that a backlash was brewing. In the third and final episode of this series, we will cover the positively vicious reaction that Imagine Dragons is going to engender, as well as the effect it had on Dan Reynolds, this golden retriever of a man. So, let me just say, guys, that Sergeant Pepper is on its way. No, yeah. No.
Should we patent the phrase the Nickelback effect? Yeah. Because that's what's going to happen here. They got too big and the music is too corny.
Too big.
So you know shit's coming on.
Yeah. But what is unique here is that, like, there's going to be an album or two that we cover in the next episode that are among the worst albums I have ever heard. For this podcast.
That actually gets me excited, though, because then we've crossed the Vitaly threshold into where I might actually find it funny.
Like this, like these albums are so bad. Like, they really are like works of art. So we're going to cover that. We're going to cover some domestic trouble for Dan Reynolds and some other shit that's going to come up in what is going to be a very dark and chaotic and fascinating Imagine Dragons Part 3.
I'm not hating it as much as I thought, because the thing is, they're an interesting group.
Yeah.
Every now and then we'll cover a group where we have to do some heavy lifting, because they're kind of a dud of a person.
That's true. I've ignored entire potential series because I actually...
Yeah, you start looking in, you're like, they're not that interesting.
Then they got signed to this level, and they did that or the other thing. But like, these guys, like, their music never made sense to me until I started to dive into the personality of the main guy involved. And all of a sudden, like, as you, like, hinted at in the first episode, it does make sense. Like, you do kind of intuitively know that, like,
this is a Mormon-ass dude.
Yeah. But the question that we're going to kind of cover in part three is, like, what happens when you take this, like, devout Mormon guy and who succeeds on his own terms, like, making this type of music and reconciling it with his values? But eventually Hollywood's going to get to you, Cal.
Yep.
Cannot spend too much time in the spotlight without just being just drowned in the allure of it all. And I think what we're going to see a little bit in part three is, like, how does Hollywood creep into this guy's Mormon brain?
The most fun part of the biopic in a movie.
Yes. This is Act 3, baby.
Yep.
So thank you so much for listening. Please be sure to give us a 5-star rating on Spotify. You make us a believer. every time you share this episode on social media, every time you hit those 5 stars, leave a comment if you're watching on YouTube, all that shit, and it makes a difference. Yeah, so follow us on Instagram, Google, Gmail, apologydirtpodcast@gmail.com is what I was trying to say. Fuck it, you already know. Just thank you for everything you do. Rock over London, rock on Madison, Northwestern Mutual, go from stress to yes.
Did you put bologna in this?
There's ham in there.
It's really weird tasting.
Is it?
We don't usually put ham in sandwiches, right? This is the first time.
No, but it's like what was in there.